It is a pleasure for me to introduce Professor Marco Antonio López Cerdà from the Department of Statistics and Operation Research of the Alicante University. Professor López has more than 100 publications in international journals. I have found 113 and near and near 650 sites from more than 200 authors. I would also like to point out that Professor López is Doctor Honoris Causa of the Limoges University in France. And Professor López, we are yours, please.
Thanks to the organizers just for inviting me to come here once again. And especially in these days, and it's a real great pleasure just to meet our friends from Ho Chi Minh University, in particular Dean and our friends from there. Okay. Today I'm talking about primal solvability in infinite dimensional convex optimization, and the results I'm presenting here today are gathered in a manuscript co-authored by Professor Goberna and Professor Mitchell Vaux, which is submitted. Okay, my object is this convex infinite programming problem. I have to minimize this objective function f of x subject to, in principle, infinitely many inequality constraints, index set by means of small t, living in this capital T index set, which has no structure, it's just a general set, index set. And aside these standard constraints, I have another one which is called abstract constraint. X must belong to a set capital C, which is a convex subset of a locally convex Hausdorff topological vector space. Of course, C must be non-zero, and I will require that all the functions involved, f and f sub t, must be proper and convex functions defined on x. Okay, the feasible set is nothing else than this intersection, the intersection of C, the abstract constraint, and the set of points satisfying the infinitely many inequality constraints. And we assume, in order to guarantee that the infimum cannot be plus infinity, we assume that this set, the intersection of the feasible set with the effective domain of f, is non-empty. And the optimal set is denoted by S of p, is the set of points in E, at which the optimal value is attained. This set can be empty, of course. And the main goal of the talk is just to characterize those situations in which this set is non-empty, and at the same time there is no duality gap. And when I talk about duality gap, I need to introduce which is the dual problem in our setting. This is a standard notation for the people involved in semi-infinite programming. It's the vector space of all the functions from T in R, such that all the values are zero except for finitely many. This is the non-negative cone in this space, of the set of functions which all the values on the points of T are non-negative, but only finitely many are different from zero. This is the standard Lagrangian dual problem, is nothing special. You know, it's a kind of bi-level optimization problem. In a first step, I select one lambda here. I form this function, this combination. This is the sum of the objective functions and the functions ft involved in the constraints, just weighted by means of the values of lambda t. In a first step, I minimize these functions on C. In a second step, in a second level, I try to find which is the best lambda, making or getting or leading to the greatest value of the first level result. Okay, because the functions are can take the value plus infinity, I need some rules which are the standard. You can find them, for instance, in the book of Rockefeller. Lambda plus infinity is plus infinity, lambda is positive, and zero times plus infinity is zero. Okay. I will denote or will represent the optimal dual value in this way, sub of d, and it's a trivial exercise for the students of the first course just to prove what we call weak dual inequality. The optimal value of the dual problem is not greater than the optimal value, the primal optimal value. The main goal of the of this talk is just to establish conditions, mainly sufficient conditions, also a kind of a characterization in the last part, guaranteeing what we is called converse strong duality. Converse strong duality means that there is no duality gap, but the optimal value, the primal optimal value, is attained. In other words, there is optimal solutions for the primal problem. Okay. To this aim, we rely on a couple of different modifications of the standard Lagrangian dual. For instance, this one is very similar. Observe that everything is the same, the objective function is the same, but now we are excluding the possibility of lambda to be identically zero. The standard here, lambda can be zero. In this case, the objective functions in the first level problem is reduced to the objective functions, but in this surrogate or modified Lagrangian dual, we are precluding the possibility of lambda to be zero. Okay, that means that as far as I'm considering less feasible solutions in the second level problem, this maximum will be less or equal to the dual optimal value for the standard Lagrangian. So this is the relationship. So I have, this is the weak inequality, dual inequality, and observe that the dual optimal value of the standard dual is the maximum of the optimal value of this problem, which correspond to all the possible lambdas different from zero. And when I take lambda equal to zero, I get here the infimum over C of the objective functions. And so this sub value is the maximum of these two, and so the maximum is greater or equal to each one. But if I prove, if I'm able to prove that this sub is equal to this inf, of course, this term in the center also will coincide. I will have no duality gap. So one way to attack the problem is just to guarantee or to establish conditions guaranteeing that this sub coincides with the primal optimal value. By the way, these two values can be very different. And so that means that this inequality, Brout inequality, can be strict, and the gap can be very, very big. For instance, look at this very simple example. Consider that X, also C, is the whole real line. The objective function is exponential of X. And I have only one constraint, and by the way, the constraint is very simple, is X. So that means that the surrogate dual consists in calculating the supremum for positive lambdas, lambda zero is excluded, of this infimum. But when I have this term here, and lambda is positive, the infimum of this function is minus infinity. Meanwhile, the infimum of C is zero. Remember that the exponential infimum is zero, and C is the whole line. And so the difference between this supremum is exactly zero, and this other is minus infinity. A first step may consist, somebody may be interested in establishing under which conditions I have equality here. This sub coincides with the standard dual optimal value for the standard Lagrangian dual. Okay, this is a condition which is very simple to prove. The proof is two lines. I don't have time just to repeat the proof. Assume that there exists a non-zero lambda in this positive cone, such that this function here is bounded from below over this set. Then we have that two duals have the same optimal value. Okay, here is the proof, it's very simple. But the problem is that this condition here, there must exist a lambda, non-identically zero, such that this condition must be bounded from below. This condition never applies for the linear case. If the functions ft are affine, never is bounded from below. The sum of affine functions is affine functions and is never bounded from below. It depends on C, of course, but if C is the whole space, it's never bounded from below. Okay, next we will provide conditions ensuring the existence of optimal points. That means that this mean exists. There are points at which the optimal primal value is attained, and the surrogate optimal value coincides, and so the standard Lagrangian optimal value is in the middle and so also coincides. I have no duality gap, and this problem, the primal problem, is solvable. These are the preliminaries. Part of the preliminaries, there are other definitions, quite standard, I will introduce now. There is a part devoted to min-sup. Min-sup is this kind of results. Minimum attained for the primal problem, and coincides with the supremum of the dual problem. We have no duality gap. And this type of results in this section assume are given through some incompactness conditions. But these incompactness conditions does not hold in general for the linear case. The linear case is very important, and so we need just to give a step further and considering the possibility of relaxing these conditions and introducing new ones which are weaker. And finally, I will be able to give a kind of characterization of mean subduality by means of a closeness assumption of similar type of the one that Professor Dean introduced today. In the middle, just we will compare with some results new in the field of linear semi-infinite programming and other ones which are new also for semi-infinite or infinite linear programming. Okay, concerning notation is the standard. Just to call your attention to the fact that cone of B denotes the convex cone generated by B and contains always the zero, even when B is the empty set. And this is the standard notation for the duality product, and here we use the positive and negative dual cones of the set C, and this is the recession cone. All the sets C considered in this paper and in this talk are convex, sometimes closed, other times we can relax closeness. So this is also a standard. G, suppose that G is a function from this space X, and with values in the extended in both sides real line, we will say that this function is inf compact or inf locally compact when all the lower level sets denoted in this way, which are defined as the set of points and the space, such that the value of the function is less or equal to R, all these sets for every R are compact or locally compact respectively. Now I'm remembering here a very important result in convex analysis, in infinite dimensional convex analysis. For instance, you can find them in is theorem 646 in Laurent book in the of 72. Assume that this is a convex function defined in the dual space. It's also valid for a function defined in the primal. But I am applying this result for one function defined on the dual space with values in the extended real line, which is finite and tau continuous and a point x bar star of x star. That means continuous with respect to the Mackey topology. Then the function has subgradients. The subdifferential is non-empty. This result is important, but even more important is this one. Suppose that this function additionally belongs to this gamma. That means that a side to be convex is proper and lower semicontinuous, and is finite and tau continuous, continuous with respect to the Mackey topology. In this case, this function here, the conjugate translated by means of this point here, this is a point in the dual space, this is a function, and so this is a translated function, is a weak inf compact. That means that the sublevel sets of these functions, all of them, are weakly compact. Okay, as I said before, gamma of x star is the standard notation for the family of proper convex functions, which are weak star Lover semicontinuous. Well, they are Lover semicontinuous for any topology compatible with the dual pair. Okay, come on again to my primal problem. I want to minimize this function with these constraints. And in this section, I'm assuming the closeness of C, and also that all the functions are present in the problem are in the family gamma. This function is not very popular, but Professor Vohl uses many times in his papers, and so he exploits the property of these functions. At least I use it two or three times in my joint papers with him. Apparently it's a stage function because it's a function defined in the dual space with values in the extended real line, which is defined as the infimum for every possible non-negative lambda excluding the zero of these conjugate functions. Here, by the way, this is the indicator functions. Okay? This is something strange, it's the infimum of conjugate functions of an infinite family of conjugate functions. This is a keystone in our approach. This function H enjoys the following properties. First, H is proper and convex, and by the way, the conjugate is very simple. It's nothing else than the sum of the indicator F, objective functions, plus the indicator of C, plus the indicator of F. Remember, the F is the set of points satisfying all the constraints. And what is more important, this result here. Assume that X bar is a subgradient of this function. This happens if and only if this x bar is optimal, because the value attained or taken by the function f at x bar coincides with the optimal value of the surrogate dual. And so, because the relationship, that means that there is no duality gap, and because this is optimal, I have optimal solutions for the primal problem. But this is equivalent. They say that every subgradient is optimal solution for the primal problem, and there is no duality gap. And so the problem now is reduced to characterize those situations in which this subdifferential is non-empty. And this comes by means of this result here. This result here. Okay, and so my task now is just to try to characterize those situations or to provide conditions guaranteeing that the subdifferential is non-empty. Okay, the condition is this one. In this theorem we prove that assuming that there exists a lambda bar, non-zero, such that this function here is weak, compact, then this minimum coincides with this supremum, this is in the middle and have no duality gap. And what is more important, the optimal set is a non-empty, weakly compact set. This is quite strong. To be, and that means that this weakly compact is quite strong. We will see another situations in which relaxing these conditions, we get a kind of extension, not so strong like this one. Okay. If in fact F plus the indication is itself weak if compact, that means that here lambda is zero, I get the same result by not by means of this proof. I cannot use the function H. I have to use another tool. And one particular case is when C is in fact weak compact, but to have C if compact is quite strict. In general, C is a cone, it's not compact. Okay, this is a corollary. When I have one point in this convex hull generated by all the effective domains of the conjugates, such that again I have the same conditions, F, not the same exactly. Here I have F plus the indicator plus this point here, not the sum of lambda t, F of t. When this function is weak, if compact, I have no duality gap, and optimal solutions for the primal problem. The conclusion is the same, but this condition changes a little bit. Assume we try to apply the result of this corollary. This corollary is especially indicated just for dealing with the linear case. My linear semi-infinite problem is this one. This is the objective functions, they are the constraints. Here the dual and the original space, all of them are the Euclidean space. And the last corollary, this corollary, asserts if there exists one point in the convex congenerated by T star, the convex congenerated by this one, this is exactly this condition here. Such that this set here, the recession cone intersected with this half space is zero, then three holes, and the optimal set of the problem is non-empty and compact. But what happens with C is the whole space, which is quite standard. In this case, this is the whole space. And so what is this? This is the whole space if C star is minus A star. And so this intersection is the whole space. If C star is different of minus C star, so this sum is not zero, this is a half space. So that means that these conditions never happens. And so this theory, assuming weak inf compactness, does not apply for the linear case. And so we have to look for another approach covering the linear case. What is done in the second part of the presentation. Okay. In this case, we are relaxing the inf compactness conditions, and we need to introduce, not to reintroduce, to remember, this definition, which is an extension of the continuity. This definition concept was introduced by Jolie and Laurent, and also Professor Wall with Masawi work in a couple of papers with this condition, characterizing and applying this condition in different frameworks. I say that one function in gamma, that means it's a convex, proper and lower semi-continuous. Again, Y is a locally convex Hausdorff topological vector space, is quasi-continuous if the affine hole or the effective domain of H is closed, it's regular in the sense it's closed, and of finite codimension. That means that it's very big. It's very big. And the relative interior of the effective domain is non-empty, and the restriction of H to the affine hole of the domain is continuous on the relative interior. Okay, in the case that H is continuous in one point, automatically these conditions hold, because if it's continuous in a point, you know that it's equivalent to be continuous in the interior of the domain. The interior of the domain is full dimensional, and so this affine hole is the whole space, and so it's closed, and everything aside this condition is also happens because the continuity is guaranteed in the interior of the effective domain. When the function is continuous, everything happens, and so it's a relaxation, it's a way to weaken the continuity. This is very nice result. This also you can find also in the book of Laurent. Suppose that G is lower semi-continuous proper and convex function, which is weak if locally compact. This happens if and only if the conjugate is quasi-continuous, these conditions, for the Mackey topology. So the quasi-continuity for the Mackey topology is characterized in terms of the weak inf locally compactness of the function. That means that all the lower level sets are locally compact for the weak topology. And this is another result in the line of the standard results of Mitchell-Wall. Suppose that H is a function from Y in the standard real line, which is convex and quasi-continuous. I have one point at which the function is not minus infinity, and the closure of the convex cone generated by the effective domain translated in this way is a linear subspace. Then the subdifferential is the sum of a non-empty weak star compact convex set plus a finite dimensional linear subspace. So in this case I don't get compactness, I get the sum of a weak star compact convex set plus a finite dimensional linear subspace. This important particular case is very useful in some applications. When the closure of this convex cone is the whole space, thanks to the fact that this affine hole is closed in the definition, I have that h is continuous and y is zero, and so in this is a particular case in which the subdifferential is weak star compact and non-empty, and so this finite dimensional linear subspace is confined to zero. This is important, it's the case of full dimensionality. Of course all these results are satisfied in the finite dimensional setting. This is the main result. It seems the condition is quite similar to the one you said before in the first part. I'm again assuming the existence of lambda bar, so that this function is now is not inf compact, is inf locally compact. Inf locally compact. Okay, now I don't have problems with the linear functions. But the problem I have now is that in the Euclidean space, of course, the Euclidean space is locally compact. And so this condition happens for free in the Euclidean space. The Euclidean space, this condition is free. Okay, in general, under this condition of being weak, infralocally compact, if at the same time the closure, weak star closure of this set is a linear subspace, I have again mean sup, no duality gap, and this set is the sum of a non-empty, weak, compact, convex set and a finite dimensional linear subspace. In this case, this is weaker, but also the conclusion is weaker. If this function is itself weak, inf locally compact, then the conclusion is still valid, but again, the way to prove the result is independent. It's not a, it's a second result, is a second part of the theorem, which is not based in the first part. Okay, this condition here, I don't like, I have to just to confess that I don't like very much, but it's equivalent to this other one, which is more in the flavor of convex analysis. This condition is completely equivalent to this one. This is the intersection, these are the recession cones of the objective function, the intersection, the recession cones of the functions f t, and the recession cone of c, this intersection must be a linear subspace. Okay, I like more this, this formulation of the condition, but when x is the Euclidean space, I'm in the convex semi-infinite programming, this function here is trivially weak if locally compact, because the Euclidean space is locally compact. And so the first condition is free, and this condition 4, this one of this one, is expressed in these terms. Or equivalently, the zero in the Euclidean space must be to the relative interior of this set plus the relative interior, the sum of relative interiors. Consider now the primal ordinary convex programming problem. This is an application. Here I have only finitely many constraints. This is the standard dual. And applying the last theorem, we get a quite big generalization of this important Clark-Dufin theorem, which says the following: all the functions are of the family gamma, belong to the family gamma. I have this condition here, is a linear subspace, this set is a linear subspace. In this case, I have no duality gap, optimal solutions for the primal, and the optimal set, primal optimal set, is the sum of a non-empty compact convex set and a linear subspace. Okay. And finally, for the linear case, I have this result here, assuming that C is a convex convex cone. If C is weak locally compact, because now I'm not in the Euclidean space, X is a locally convex space, in this case, the optimal value of the problem P is attained and coincides with the supremum, the optimal value of the dual. And the dual in this case is nothing else than the hard dual, the one that we use in semi-infinite programming. Again, S of P is the sum of a non-empty, weak, compact, convex set, a finite dimensional linear subspace. We derived the result just directly in the Euclidean space in our book, for instance, with Professor Goberna. Finally, if we deal with the linears in infinite programming, I'm in this setting here. This C is still a closed and convex cone. This set must be a linear subspace. This is condition 4, but this condition is equivalent to this one. And when C is the whole space, this condition is nothing else than the standard condition minus C star must belong to the relative interior of the convex cone generated by T star. This is a well-known condition, we use this one. In this case, we know that there is no pseudoality gap, and the optimal set is again the sum of non-empty compact. I don't need to say weak compact because all the topologies are equivalent in the Euclidean space, plus a linear subspace. Of course, finite dimensional, because the whole space is finite dimensional. And if this cone here is full dimensional, in this case, S of P is just a compact convex set. Okay, I don't have more time just to talk about the last part, but the last part is just comes by introducing this other surrogate. Observe that here the set of lambdas is the same, but here C must belong to this intersection. C is the abstract, the constraint set, and M is the intersection of all the effective domains. So this inf is greater, and so this maximum is greater, and now the relation is this one. That means that if I prove that this supremum coincides with this infimum, I'm not sure that this supremum coincides with this. It's a different. And never we got this result, this is the main result here. If there exists a lambda bar such that this infimum is bounded, is a real number, then I have this kind of duality with optimal solutions for the primal problem, and this is equivalent to the fact that this set here must be closed regarding to this set. This is a kind of closeness condition. This is a topological concept used, for instance, by Bott, many authors. If I'm in a topological space, we say that one set is closed regarding to B if B intersected with the closure coincides with B intersected with A. In this case, we say that A is closed with respect to B. Okay. This provides a kind of not the standard Farkas lemma. This is a consequence, not the standard Farkas lemma. And the set C appears here. And this is the version for the linear semi-infinite. I have no dual gap with the dual in the sense of Haar and the standard primal if this set is closed regarding to this set here. Okay, these are the main references. Again, the same paper mentioned by Dean. This is the standard paper by Duffin in 78. And this is the this couple of papers were key for the introduction of this kind of quasi-continuity of a convex function in the papers of Joly and Laurent. And these are the papers of Moussaoui and Wall. They use and exploit the property of quasi-continuity. And this is all. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, any question or comment? Please.
I have seen that you have mentioned the references.
A recent paper still unpublished by Ernst and Wohl. But so probably you cannot use the results in your context, no? Because they are using, if I remember well, a more classical approach. And so it's related but disjoint, let's say.
We are not applying this. Exactly.
I mean this paper. But now I'm thinking in the opposite direction, that maybe their results can be obtained as consequences of your results. I don't know why, because even though your approach looks very particular, because you are using these generalized sequences instead of the dual space, But I think, I may be wrong, that every infinite program can be reformulated as a, in your way. I mean, as a semi-infinite program, let's say, with infinitely many constraints, no? I mean, a general problem would be the constraints, let's say, g of x belongs to a cone, a closed convex cone. And then you can reformulate this abstract constraint with infinitely many constraints, which...
Just going to the dual cone.
And then you can apply your
ideas. So I don't know. I mean, even if your approach apparently is more particular, but thanks to this more structure, you can do more things. You can apply more powerful techniques. And so if a general problem is formulated in your way, maybe this will be useful. No? It's a suggestion. I don't know if...
Okay. This is, from one side, it's a standard in the sense that this is the Lagrange dual when you have infinitely many constraints and the set of indices, capital T, has no structure. Because in capital C, for instance, is a compact space, you can, and the functions are continuous, you can go to the dual of the space of continuous functions and consider regular Borel measures, and the scalar product is the integral, and this is another stuff. But it's another
much
stuff.
Complicated.
Much more complicated. And this is...
Your approach is nicer, let's say.
Yes, okay. What was really pleasant for us is that some results already present in our book, in the book of Miguel and me, were recaptured by means of this approach. Mm-hmm. Yeah? And so this is why we devote some sections to or some parts to applications in the setting of semi-infinite programming or convex semi-infinite programming. And so. And also, what is interesting, but okay, is the expertise of our colleague Professor Wall, is to characterize the optimal set is nothing else than the subdifferential of the function h. This is the key. The optimal set is the subdifferential of the function h. And okay, if you know a lot of things about the subdifferential of one function, you have plenty of possibilities to provide results. And one key is, for instance, this concept of quasi-continuity, which is characterized by means of a locally incompactness of the conjugate. And so it's... Okay.
Any questions?
I have a question.
Please.
It is possible that conditions that guarantee no duality gap not be sufficient to guarantee that the optimal values of the dual problem and the surrogate one do not coincide, or?
Okay, you suggest to treat independently the problem of the existence of optimal solutions. Okay, I think that the key is you cannot separate this. When you have one point in this subdifferential, in other words, this subdifferential is non-empty, automatically this subdifferential coincides with the optimal set of the primal problem and there is no duality gap. Both things in general go together. Okay, in my book with Professor Goberna, is in the finite dimensional setting. We have the dual optimal value and the primal optimal value. One of them is the closure of the other. They coincide in the relative interior of the effective domain. In the points of the boundary of the effective domains, many different things may happen. So always the same. So in this case, in some points of the boundary of the relative effective domain of these functions, you can have duality gaps, and despite this, you can have optimal solutions for the primal. So certainly, it's possible to have optimal solutions for the primal, despite that there is duality gap. Both optimal values perhaps do not coincide.
Please,
just one. It's not a question. Just a very small question is for the definition of income package, so normally people need C1R. So now you need the definition of some of the first definition. Okay, income package. So you need here is every R. I don't know what here. What is the special reason for this? But normally, with one R, then is enough.
You're
so,
in the sense that here we have assuming convexity in the definition, but when you deal with convex functions, I think that at least in the finite dimensional case, if for one
for every R, for all of them, for. If provided that the lower set is non-empty. If the lower set is non-empty, if one of them is compact, all of them are compact in the finite dimensional. I think is the if the function is not convex, of course not.
No.
So, and so perhaps you should give a condition for particular R.
When it is in for some R, then some R prime less than R. Then it's the same.
For free,
Yes. Yes. If the function is lower semi-continuous, you have that a closed set in a compact Hausdorff space.
That's right. And then you have some special reason to.
Convexity.
No, without convex.
I suppose that if we try to extend this stuff, this theory for general functions, the definition cannot be the same.
Any question? Then thanks again.